Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this afternoon's discussion panel on e-commerce and niche perfumery 2017, opportunities and pitfalls. Yeah, come in. It is a pleasure to have the opportunity to speak with you and dedicate an entire discussion panel on the topic of e-commerce. It is a topic that is sometimes being treated with some sort of emotion in one way or another. And what you will see is this. You will not only see us talking about opportunities and pitfalls or threats of e-commerce in the segment of niche perfumery. We will be sharing experiences. We will be sharing expectations with you. And then also we will look at some, say, trends or latest developments in e-commerce and perfumery. So to get a better understanding of where we are at the moment and where we might be heading at. So it is my pleasure to present to you this high-profile guest at the round table. You see a combined several decades of expertise in niche perfumery. You will see, or you see, multiple perspectives because they represent multiple roles of niche perfumery. And therefore, I'm very, very honored to have you on board. So, without further ado, let me individually present my panelists. I need to press on the green button, so I've been told. Right. So on my left, we have Ms. Bailey Leeds from New York. She is the president of Robert Piguet Parfum, the legendary fragrance house by iconic fashion designer Robert Piguet. The first fragrance was launched in 1944 Bandit. So we have a fragrance house that has a long history, a rich heritage. So thank you for being here, Bailey. Next to her, we have got Ms. Renata Fazudinova. She's the co-founder and owner of a beautiful niche perfumery in Paris called Sens Unique. And she opened the store, or the boutique, about 6 years ago, is that correct? 6 years ago. And more than that, she's also she has also developed her online activities, or is keeping developing her online activities. So she's a retailer who does e-commerce as well. Then we have Monsieur François Duquesne, also from New York, CEO of Beauty Enterprise, which is the fragrance house behind Edis de Venustas or Le Cercle des Parfumeurs Créateurs. François is not only a consultant specialized in developing brands in the niche perfumery, he's not only a distributor, but he's also an innovative mind when it comes to finding new ways of finding new segments, finding new customers in a niche perfumery segment. And then last but not least, Dottore Silvio Levi. He is not only Calais president, a distributor, he's not only a visionary and an evangelist, fighter for this cause, but also, as you know, Essence's founder. As for myself, my name is Hario Sedono. I am German, it's not a typical German name. I'm a German-based e-commerce consultant. I have launched numerous online perfumeries and I've built my entire career in e-commerce. But more importantly, I'm a perfume aficionado. Let's kick the discussion off with a general question, which is quite straightforward. So what role does e-commerce play in your respective strategy? And since you, François, with Edis de Venustas, it is present in a couple of online boutiques, maybe you want to start off.
Merci. I reside on the west coast of the USA, and I can witness that e-commerce is playing today the major role in a brand strategy overall, and slowly in the brand's perfume strategy as well. There are, I think, two simple reasons for that. And I think it's just the beginning. I have been in this market because I had the chance to run a company called L'Artisan Parfumeur at the time, in the 2000s. And I had the chance to meet the founder of L'Artisan Parfumeur, Jean Laporte, at the time, who told me when he started, so a grandfather of the niche parfumery in a way, how difficult it was to reach your client through a classic perfume distribution. So that the only way was to be direct. And if you are in direct contact with your clientele, then you can develop the brand. That's why he started L'Artisan Parfumeur with a shop concept, not going through distributors, not going through retailers, just direct, la prise directe, like we say in French, with the consumer. And that's how many beauty and fragrance business have been developed all over the years. I started my career with Yves Rocher, same approach, L'Occitane. It's people who have a direct contact with the consumer. So today, it's the same situation. The market may seem very open for niche perfumery, but it is not. Everyone who is here independent will tell you how hard it is to find your distribution channel. Renata, I'm sure you can tell every week you have someone calling you, can you get my fragrance through this one? So internet is the natural opportunity to go direct to the consumer. So it will happen. It has to happen. There is no other way than cranking that opportunity. But how? So when I worked to the fashion people 15 years ago, they were saying, but you know, a dress, you have to wear it, so it's never going to sell on the internet. And today, in the USA, the first distribution channel across the board for apparel is Amazon. It's bigger than Macy's, who has more than 600 retails. It's more than Gap. It's more than all these people combined. So there will be something happening. And the challenge, just to finish on that, I don't want to, is for replenishment. It's obvious. Replenishment means you have been using your Chanel number 5 and then you go online to replenish your Chanel number 5. You don't need to go to a perfumery to discover. But we are in an industry where people want to experience. So the challenge is how can you experience and discover new perfumery online? And that's, I think, the subject that where I'm very excited to work on different projects like that. And this is where I'm very positive that things will happen, because there is a generation out there who is having the Warby Parker glasses, for instance, if you know the business model, who is ready to experience that differently.
Thank you, François. Bailey, you have I know that Robert Piguet Parfum has maybe a rather restrictive approach when it comes to e-commerce. So what is your take on the strategy of the role of e-commerce in Robert Parfum Piguet strategy?
Yeah, I think, sorry, I've had a little bit of a cold, so I hope you can understand me. Hario, I think for us, restrictive probably is more cautious, I think, is a more appropriate word.
Okay.
Unfortunately, I think there's a lot of people here today in this show that have experienced a lot of the negative part of the internet that we have, which is that somehow, somewhere, someone sells our products to an internet company that discounts it, okay? It hurts our brand. It hurts our distributors, our partners, our business partners. It makes what is a very special brand a lot less special. That is why we, at this point, are really adopting a rather cautious approach to the internet, because we want to be able to protect our brand. We have incredible partners, but somewhere along the line, our products are leaking out and finding themselves in a place that we don't necessarily want them. For us, our strategy is really about trying to find internet partners that are going to do what we feel very strongly about, which is talking about our brand in the right way, being very specific about the history, the legacy of our brand. And also because we have such an incredible reference, you know, a selection of references that are so unique, making sure that however they're presenting themselves on the internet is going to be appropriate and spot on in terms of what each of those references is really about. Tell the real story behind each of these fragrances because they all deserve the story to be told. So we want to make sure that whatever we do in terms of partnering on the internet, it fills that criteria. We never want discount. We want to be partners. We want to find a way to bring the brand alive. But because, as Hario points out, we came from 1944, it's very hard to become internet savvy and internet able when you have such a heritage and such a long and well-known and old fragrance house. I likened much of it to the fact that when you look at traditional retailers and you look at the publishing world and you look at the music world, how the internet has changed everything and how business has changed, it's unfortunately when you're working upstream, it can be very difficult. And that's sort of how we are. We're working upstream because we're a small niche company and we have to work very slowly and effectively as we can.
Thank you, Bailey. We will certainly have the opportunity to talk about what you raised, the question of discounts. So there will be a question about this element also. Sylvia, because you don't only have Calais Fragrance d'Autore, but you are also the distributor. What role does, or how do you play e-commerce in your strategy?
So the main experience we have, I have in reality, is with Nose. So
right.
I'm one of the founder of Nose in Paris, and Nose has 5 years experience in the internet sales. Then we have some open recently also e-commerce in Italy, but limited to the brand we distribute. It's a very complex to come in internet in a proper manner with e-commerce. I think you have to invest a proper amount of money. It's very important how to promote it. And mainly, I think the duty is to respect the value of the brand, so giving an image, protecting the brand, not simply to have shelves, electronic shelves. We don't need it. We need something that is teaching the story, is telling the story about the brand, involving people. So, for example, in Nose, we have a sort of magazine. So interview to the Noses, explaining something about the brand. Also, if there's a little more, then we have also a very typical e-commerce. While, for example, for a lot of years, we was the first company in Italy opening a website. But for until 2 years ago, we never publish a price. We speak only about the brand. We never sell something. And that takes a lot of time in order to let also the retailers to come into the website in order to get information, to stay updated. And then that is the first step. The other point is a lot of retailers have their own e-commerce. And very, very often they're awful. So something prêt-à-porter, not the brand, not the distribution, but something they buy and they think they simply publish something. And the other very big risk, but we'll discuss, I suppose, later on, is the marketplace. So when retailers use marketplaces supplied by some other organization, and so we lose completely the identity of the seller. So I think the identity of the seller is something very important also in the net. Because we are selling something special, so I need to know who is the man, the guys that's selling me these goods. What is the know-how behind? What is the knowledge of the story of the brand they are proposing? And that is a little complicated to do, because it's not really commercial.
Right.
It's an investment.
Thank you, Silvio. Now, Renata, because you are the retailer, you're on the other end of the spectrum, if you will, and you started off with a physical boutique. So e-commerce, when you engage more and more in e-commerce, tell us a little bit about why you do it and how you do it.
Well, in our perspective, actually, I think that you always have to know what you want from your e-commerce. So in our experience, for example, we started with a brick boutique, and then we always had our website, but which was mostly dedicated to the people who come to the store and then they live somewhere abroad. And of course, when they are out of their perfume, we want to be the ones to sell to them. So I would always give our card saying, so if you need another bottle, just contact us with the phone number or the on our internet site. So we never really sold through internet. It was really to, as you said, to replenish the next bottle. And then less than a year ago, just a couple of months ago, we started using internet in a different way. So we decided to, you know, we sell in a city which was a lot touched by the different events since 2 years. So of course, we do have a lot of French clients, but we also have a lot of international clients who decreased, to be honest and completely transparent. So we kind of had to find this way to keep communicating with our existing clients, but also with the new ones. So we launched what we call the Sens Unique Box. This was our first step to the internet, not just only. I like the way Silvio said that you're not, a brand is not interested in having just internet shelves, but they want to have an experience. So the idea was how to make Sens Unique experience come to the house to everywhere, like maybe in Paris, in France, in the world, everywhere. So that's where we created the subscription type, where we would send samples, but also the descriptions of every perfumes, and we always do it under our own sauce. So you don't choose what you're receiving, it's Sens Unique who's deciding. And ever since, we received a lot of different messages from our clients, from Russia, from the USA, and from New Zealand, and wherever it was in the world, saying that, hi, I've been to your store 2 years ago, I never had the opportunity to come back, and now that you have this service, it's so cool because I have you coming to my home every month. But then this is different from you were saying about all the retailers, you know, like doing bad stuff on the internet, then, and I think that in all of this, to say, probably, that today we live in a world where physical retail and internet retail are kind of fusing, as well as the what you are in real life and what you are on internet, would it be a brand or a person? It's today so fused, messed up, if I may say, and everything, so it depends on the way you use it. That's how you will choose your direction. So I think that the choice of retailers, physical ones and the internet ones, are kind of becoming the same. And you do have the awful website, but then I think as a retailer, you also have to work, if you're opening a website, like you're not opening a point of sale with just shelves which are not beautiful, with the people who don't know anything, because if you have just the names of the perfumes and the prices, it's basically having salespeople who are just able to give you the name and the price. And that's why you are trying to train people, and that's how you get your content in a physical store, but this applies perfectly to internet as well. So I think that today, like, reality and virtual part of our life, they're so connected that you kind of have to do the same thing in both of them, and if you cannot do it, don't open it. And you always have to stay updated in a physical store as on the internet. So I think that to answer your question about internet in the strategy, I think it's indispensable today because that's how people get information. But you also have to be very careful about it as a brand, as a store, as a person, as anybody, like what you're communicating, because that's the message people will get.
Thank you. So if we take a, if you summarize this or combine what you just said, so basically I have people who say it is indispensable, this is the way to communicate with people and give them the opportunity to buy the products. On the other hand, there's the constraint, and we will speak about this in the next question, there's a constraint of how can I make sure that the brand is being sold in a manner that I want it to be sold. So this gives us the opportunity to go right into the gist, the core of the panel, which is the next question. What do you think are today's opportunities and pitfalls or threats of e-commerce and niche perfumery? We have heard some pitfalls, like the discounts. Would you like to add something to this, Bailey? Because you already expressed your
And I don't mean it. I mean, I'm a big fan of the internet, so don't get me wrong. I certainly believe in the internet. It's I think when I was on Karen's panel last year, I talked about the fact that you know, it's amazing when you see one of the Kardashians put something on Instagram and all of a sudden Estee Lauder is sold out of that one lipstick or something in a matter of minutes. So, you know, social media, the internet, it all is something we can't ignore. So we know we have to be there. I think there's a couple two-pronged approach about the pitfalls for us. When we partner with our distributors in certain countries, we certainly have territories we ask them to be very strict about. We want to make sure that we're not going to overstep, make sure they're not going to overstep the bounds. When we're talking about the internet and distributing all over the world, you start, you know, challenging the relationship you've had and created with that distributor. So it puts, you know, you have to make sure that we're all going to be happy ultimately. And the other thing, ultimately, and the other thing as well is the fact that you again want to make sure that you're not going to be put in a situation, which Renata you put so eloquently, where your fragrance is put up, there's no description, it's up there, there's the discounted price or there's the price, and there's nothing going on about talking about the fragrance, talking about the history of the house. There's nothing there. I mean, when we want to be in a store, we want to make sure that we're presented so on brand. We make sure that our marketing and our merchandising is really particular to what we're about. And that's what you want to be, is what you were saying, and Silvio as well, about the internet. You want to be in a virtual store that is telling the story you want to be told. And that's really, that can be a pitfall, because you're not sure you can guarantee that necessarily on the internet. And there's so many opportunities out there. And what was I going to say? The threats, well, yes, the discount threats. It's a situation that we have little or no control over. It's something that I think happens to every fragrance house, niche by definition. And I remember when I fill out my application to be here, we talk about how our distribution is. It's limited, and by the nature of the internet. The internet is not limited. It's limitless. So how do you challenge being a niche fragrance brand and being presented at a place that has no boundaries? That's where I am.
Thank you. May I maybe quick to that? There is a reality that there is a consumer out there that wants to buy any perfume products, but any product, when they want, at midnight, at the price they want, the best deal, whenever it's convenient. And that you cannot avoid, especially with a generation coming. But not just that, my mom is now addicted to that because, you know, she's over 75. And it's all about surfing in the evening and finding the right deal for the right product. So that business, protecting it with walls, I mean, doesn't work in politics, it doesn't work for perfumery either, worldly. So you have to live with that. So the question is, how do you sublimize this? And the answer is possibly trying to reach maximum positive exposure. So if your brand has a great story to tell, let's go for it. Let's diffuse it as much as possible. Let's cross the borders with that. And it's very interesting that I recently introduced a Belgian brand. It's called Baobab Collection. It's scented candles. So we're not in the perfume, but on the US market. And I went to some retailers, and they told me, we're not ready to take you. I was like, why? It's very strange. You would really be able to sell it. Said, no. You don't have a proper website yet. Like, what? Yeah. Like, so I was telling them, usually when I hear from retailer, it's like, you have a brand where when you open your own e-commerce website, it will threaten our store business and will be dead. Now you hear from retailers who have their own e-commerce website, it says, you will be an interesting brand in our assortment the day you have your own e-commerce operation in the US. Wow. Yeah, and I said, why? Because exposure. Because the consumer wants to be reassured, but you can find it in different place, at different price, at different level, that the story is properly told, And it's for them the reinsurance that your brand is wanted. If you have your own e-commerce as a brand, you show to the other retailers that you are very active in that situation in promoting your brand. And that's what, at the end of the day, what the retailer wants. You don't want to have a brand just sitting in your shelf and nothing going on at a brand level. You want the brand to be active. Where can the brand be active? Online, on the World Wide Web. So, and I know how tough it is maybe to hear that, but the experience will never be the same as the experience you offer in your Paris boutique. So I like the angle that you say, I want to be in the tourist guide so the people come and visit my boutique, because your goal as a retailer is to increase your traffic at the point of sales. So that's one way to increase the traffic and then transform the traffic into an experience that translates into a purchase. But the brand has to be there with present, and it will not compete with a retailer when they have their own e-commerce. It will actually give the retailer the reassurance that that brand is something. And that's what I see in the USA today really happening. Since 50% of the market is Amazon or Amazon-like, you have to have your own e-commerce presence. And actually, when you have a poor one, people don't consider you seriously.
But if you have your own online store, or you have your own website presence, yeah, you have your own web store, your vertical store, how do you make sure that people buy with you, François?
Sorry, how do you show that?
How do you make sure you have a beautiful web store as a brand, like yes. Bailey Leeds, for instance, for Robert Piguet Parfum, so she creates a beautiful, top-notch online boutique. How does she make sure that the people buy with her and not with...
But the people may actually not buy with her because you, as a niche brand, like you say, you have no power against Amazon, who has search engine optimization like you cannot even imagine. So when someone Googles Piguet, obviously you're never going to come first with your own e-boutique unless you do an insane investment that is involved. So you're not. But through the story, the social media, what you report about your brand, and the added service that you can offer versus... it's too bad the guys of Lucky Scent in the USA are not here today, but they offer a level of service that no one else offers, and that gives them that edge. The Aedes Perfumery, which where I'm involved in the business, they offer a special pack so you can actually buy your perfume and you get flower, you get it wrapped in a special way with fresh flowers, and you can send it to your friend for a gift. So that's an additional service that a retailer offers that is Amazon will never be able to offer: fresh flowers delivered to your friend door with a little handwritten note. Aedes can do that. So that's a way to differentiate. So you have to find ways to differentiate, but there's nothing you can do against the wave of Amazon and the pure players. We're going to crush you, because they will always come first, you know? So the experience, the visibility of the experience will make it. And actually, you will fall on that. It's going to be like the research on Google. Is like, how can I send a perfume to a friend or with a luxury gift wrapping? And then the site comes up first, because it's referenced under luxury gift wrapping. Although it's a perfume operation, it's actually about the gift wrapping. It's about the point of differentiation. So your point of duration in Paris is possibly to be a tourist destination. Then go for it to make a difference, and then you attract people sort of thing. But if you go against what the big guys go against, you have no chance, because they're much stronger.
Thank you, François. Renata.
If I may, I think I completely agree with François, and just to make it like the way it is in my head, I think that today, rules that are going, I'm probably a lot of a field person, So the rules that go for a normal boutique, for a normal retailer, they're absolutely the same rules that go for internet. And to illustrate a little bit your story about the price battles and everything, I can tell you a little anecdote that we had at Sens Unique in Paris of having this person who came. I'm not going to cite the person or the brand or anything. So we had this client who came into the store, and she said, "I just came in to say thank you." We said, "Okay, why are you thanking us?" And she said, "Well, because you made me discover this perfume from this brand that I loved a lot, and you talked so well about it that I absolutely want to buy it." So I went to BHV, which is like 300 meters from us, and I bought it with -30%, which is Galeries Lafayette. Welcome. So I think this kind of sounds like what you were talking about. You can go and read about the brand anywhere, and then you can go and buy it anywhere. So, of course, our first reaction was to pick up the phone and say, like, WTF. What's going on? It's either Sens Unique or BHV, or it may be Sens Unique and BHV, but then no discounts, please. Because we're happy to make people discover perfumes, but we kind of need them to come back and buy it from us, because otherwise, you know, like, we could just put the closed whatever sign on our door. So I think that the rules, it's about picking the right partners, because you probably want to pick the right partners in your distribution in whatever country you're talking about. And very often you also have parallel market in the real life, not only on the internet. It's just the thing that if you are sitting in Paris or in Milan or in New York, I don't think you can see every day what's happening in Russia or in the Middle East or in another country where there's a lot of gray market and a lot of parallel and a lot of people selling with the discounts, and distributors probably write about it and they probably like are very angry about it, but you don't see it that much. But when you're on the internet, it's just too obvious. So of course, it kind of looks like a bigger threat. But basically, to me, it's more or less the same things. And to illustrate what Francois was saying, I think that any brand, once again, if you want to be on the internet, you better be there in a good way. And to generate traffic on your website, I guess it works in exactly the same way as it does in real life. Because in order to be better than the big ones, I might talk about Sephora or somebody who has like a big, big leverages and big possibilities in real life. I could compare them to the Amazon on internet or anything, but people still want to go to Knows, or they still want to go to Javoy, or they still want to go to Sens Unique or to Campo Marzo or whatever, because they like the design, because they like the people, because they like the selection. Amazon has everything. They don't really have a selection. But then I'm sure that Aeda's store on the internet, they have a real selection. Like you said, they're still somewhere in between. I don't have an opinion. Like, very well. Like, if you're going on the Knows website, you're sure to find something new. You're sure to have, you know, like all the different, you have a lot of content. Just like when coming into the store, either you're coming because you know what you want and you just want to pick it from the shelf, or you're coming to see the person and usually the first question is like, "Hi, what's new?" And that's basically the question you're asking when you're going on the internet site. It's like, "Hi, what's new?" And if it's just, well, you know, we have this whole lot of different names with all these different prices, it looks more like a bourse, what do you call it? Like a marketplace. Like, you know, it doesn't really look like a niche boutique where you want to find something. So I think that what we were thinking about internet before, like internet is bad or internet is good or internet works in a different way, I think that if at some point of time we tell ourselves that actually it works in exactly the same way, you have to work on it, you have to make it beautiful, you have to make it, you know, like, and people will come back to you. They found your website once, they love it, they will probably remember it. I mean, people are not that stupid. And then to talk about prices, even sometimes you can find better prices in a different store. But luckily, you have people saying, well, I prefer to buy from you. So I will come back to you. And I guess that's how you get your clients' loyalty.
Thank you. Sylvia, I've seen you nodding a lot.
No. Obviously, I agree that we need to maintain an identity in the website. And regarding the brand, I think the brand have a duty. So having a brand, a website is very important, because you have to it depends on the different country, but very often what's happened that a distributor sell a product with a lot of information to a retailer, but not very often the retailer is capable to transfer to the final consumer everything. And very often the final consumer, especially in Italy, has a higher level of instruction than the retailer. So, and there is more a web addict. So the post-sales activity is so important. We sell a perfume, we tell something, then we create a loyalty because someone would like to know something more. So the first thing is I like the fragrance. Then I would like to know something more. I would like to explain to my friends why I love it. There is a special ingredient, there is a special story, whatever you want. So what's happened? You come back to the website in order to get information. So it's very important the post-sales. So the internet is as the shop, has post-sales. But fortunately, you don't need that I come back again. You can come back in the virtual store and having information. The other point is sometimes the website of the brand is important because it's happened sometimes retailers tell, oh, no, sorry, this fragrance is discontinued. Then you come in the website of the brand and it's still existing. So, wow, when you are representing the brand or not, that then is a more complicated discussion about the relationship between retailer, distributor, and so on.
Okay.
So it's too long. But anyway, is a window representing worldwide what is the brand with all the story. And that is not necessarily still an e-commerce. That is simply the information on the brand. Then there are some methods, like he knows what we did. We did the diagnosis online. That is not so easy, but anyway, we suggest people compile a form telling me which kind of fragrance you dress up to now. And we, through our software, we suggest you 5 fragrances, and we send you the sample. Then you get the sample, and then you have to fill the score. According to the score you give to these fragrances, we suggest you something else that is close to your desire. And so we let the people to discover something. Unfortunately, that is not perfect online because they know the brand and the name of fragrance. While in store, we don't reveal them anything about the brand and the fragrance.
I just wanted to congratulate you on this idea, because once I had a client coming in and saying like, hi, I've just been to Nose, and you know, like they have all this diagnostic and everything, so I'm wondering, how do you work here? I'm like, what do you mean? Well, how do you know what I need? Because you don't have an iPad. I was like, okay, I think I'm just gonna ask you some questions and that's it. So congratulations.
Thank you, thank you so much. So it's something that is not perfect. It's one of the possible model. But we have to let the people understand they can choose. They can realize what is the added value in a fragrance. That is not simple. Online is very complicated.
Yeah, okay.
And so we can spend some words. And then that is another theme is how to let them to smell. That is not easy. Stop.
So let me...
Just to rebound on that, it has been really interesting. The last 2 years have been so rich in experience in the USA. There has been brands that are becoming, emerge as pure player perfume brands. Something I started with the Fragrance Republic. And there's now, at least I can name 5 companies that are starting. Pinrose, Fleur, the words are...
Trunk.
I gave you, anyway, it doesn't matter. It's, what's really interesting is that you have people who started fragrance businesses, fragrance brand, and sell it purely and only on internet. And what I witnessed and noticed is how do they do, because it's good to know how do these guys do to get people to the brand. So sampling is obviously one. The test that you do with Nose is one way to enter there. But there is plenty of other ways. The key that I used with Fragrance Republic was like, let's talk about the perfumers and then see what they have created. And then, do you want to discover that they have created? So every Pinrose is going through the ingredients. They go in the rose field, for instance, and they really talk about the craft. Fleur has a completely different approach. They talk about more the technique of how it's made. So that's very, very interesting because these people are busy talking to themselves, how can I recruit clients over the internet? Because when we talk about the issues, we talk about the replenishment business, which is people know the brand and want the brand with the best deal whenever they want. But what's interesting is actually how do you bring people to your brand with through an online experience. And that's where is, I think, it's just the beginning of the exploration. And just to finish on that, that's why retail is essential. You notice that all these brands in the last 6 months have struggled as pure players and are now introduced at Sephora, it's the case of Fleur, or at Anthropology, the case of Pinrose, etc. They need the wholesale and the traditional retail presence to actually make it work. So internet alone is a very, very difficult thing. And I think it's the nature of our business that if you don't have that sniff experience with someone else to reinforce you, wow, it's beautiful on you, wow, it's a great thing, that will never, never, ever, ever be replaced. So we'll probably end up into a combination. But it's very interesting to see in our industry pure players emerging, and I'm looking forward to their development.
Thank you, François. We will be coming back to this these firms that you just mentioned at a later stage. I don't know how to segue this into the next questions, but since we talked about how to make sure that we don't get engaged with retailers that do discount the prices, for instance, or they do not represent the brand as it should be. I mean, there are a lot of e-commerce players who do it in a proper way, or retailers who do big brick and mortar and e-commerce, like Renata, or Lucky Scent, or Aus Liebe zum Duft, Fessy Fragrance, or Skins NL. Maybe some of you can share a little of your experience that you have made with e-commerce partners. What are your expectations, or what are the criteria? I mean, I have heard some by Bailey, do not do any discounts, for instance, it's just an example. So maybe anyone who wants to share.
Just quickly, there's nothing you can do against discount on the web. You may supply a retailer that goes out of business, and because there is a bankruptcy case, he has to get rid of whatever inventory he has, and it will be 50% off, and he will pollute. But there's nothing you can do about this guy who just went out of business, unless you have a LVMH type of business where you master your own distribution and you have Louis Vuitton, and Louis Vuitton is never on sale unless it's a fake, but because they master a distribution from their boutique all the way to the production. But otherwise, it's nature of business that it's discounted.
We will have the opportunity to ask questions, so not to worry. So if you can hold this, excellent. Okay, let's go to the next question then. We have talked a little bit about the models of the Sens Unique box, and there's a tendency or a development recently in e-commerce that you have more and more retail stores or e-commerce or websites who offer paid sampling vials, curated boxes, in order to make the consumer have the possibility to sniff first and then buy the original size. You have this kind of model. Tell us a little bit about it, Renata. Did you do it independently? How are you being perhaps supported by brands, and what do brands think about it?
Well, I guess as we are supported by the brands in everything we do, of course, we're supported by the brands in this program as well, because I guess it should be the synergy between the retailer and the brand, just like the brands, I don't know, whatever we are talking about, different merchandising programs and events and testers and samples in the store. I guess we have to implement the same thing on the internet. So if we were the only ones, because everybody's interested in sampling, everybody's interested in making more and more people at least have the opportunity to smell your perfume. I'm not talking only about, I mean, you cannot sell more if you don't have more people knowing it. So the idea is that the brands can propose their perfume to at least X amount of people every month who are already targeted people. So these are people who love perfume, these are people who know Sens Unique, so probably people who like our selection and the niche perfumery, and they probably either already know the brand or not yet. And when people come to the store, they cannot smell everything. That's normal, because otherwise, I'm not only your nose would break, but, you know, you all understand why. And as I said, it helps those who have been to the store who cannot come back there. It also, I mean, it's a great program. What can I say? And I was also thinking about all the internet activity of different ready-to-wear companies, because I'm a lot into fashion as well. In ready-to-wear, you can order anything. You can see the pictures, so it's easy. You are ordering the thing. You're trying it on. You don't like it, you send it back. You cannot really do this with perfume, unless you send the perfume with the sample, which would probably be easier. I guess that would be the next step, is to sell the perfume with the same sample. So you have to try the sample first, and while the perfume is not open, you can send it back. But then that looks a lot like Amazon. So the idea of sampling answers to the question, we're in the sniffing business, so how do we make people smell it? Luckily, we have the little 2 milliliter vials. And as I say a lot when presenting Sens Unique box, of course, it's sample, so I would love to offer them to everyone, but for simple reasons, we cannot. So we're still offering it to those who are buying the bottle behind. So we are offering the discount, which is the cost of the box, if you're deciding to buy one of the perfumes in the box, because the idea behind is to make people smell, but also to make people love and to adopt the perfume and wear it afterwards.
So this is a retailer's initiative, as I hear, because you have multiple brands in your store or in your boutique. So it is an initiative that comes from you or from the retailer. So how do the brands perceive it? What do you think, Silvio?
So 2 points. So we have a support, especially nose, by the brands. So we ask them to have a support in free of charge products. We transform in samples and we use it. The other point is we have an algorithm that lets us to identify, for example, in the people that already made a purchase, which kind of preferences they have. So every time a new product is coming in, we can have a special mailing only to this one, the people that love this typology of fragrance, informing them that we have a new fragrance and asking them to click if you want to receive a sample. So that is limiting and make a little more logic the investment, so you're not giving sample for everyone. But that implies, obviously, that someone already made a purchase, you have already the profile. You know? The advantage of that is, anyway, that in the networking nodes all over Europe is make easy for everyone, because if you give you my name in my shop, your name in my shop, and you made a purchase in Skins in the Netherlands, I get your profile, so I can immediately propose you something that is close to your desire. The other point, I think, when you have not enough software or something that you helping you, for example, in our shop in Milan, we use a 7 family, no? So the 7 colors ribbon on the tester, and the 7 family from the Société Française de Parfumerie, so the basic, so the woody, the floral, etc. So if someone is coming in the shop, we help them to not be confused too much following the pink if they're looking for floral, or the woody if you're looking for wood. So there are some messages you can give also in the net, for example, using color, identifying the typology, etc. It would be better to have a common language, and that is not easy, because you could decide to have a uni system, like we can use microhydras, for example, a family. So we have filtering the proposal in the internet, making it easier. Because the point is, someone is coming to your shop and you can interview him, looking in the eyes. But someone is coming to your website and see for 750 fragrances. It's a drama. So it's a discussion I have sometimes with Auslübe Zunduft, for example. Now they have not a specific manner to drive you inside. And so I think you have to help people. So the role of the retailer and the role of the virtual shop is to let the people discover what they love. So help them. So make it easy. So it's something that for internet is obvious. So touch and do something.
I'd love to witness a business that started in New York 2 years ago. It's called Scentbird. L'Oiseau, Scentbird.com. And it demonstrates, and they really do it, and these people raised over $5 million. So they have succeeded in over 2 years to reach 150,000 clients, members. It's a membership-based system. And you become a member, and you get a little purse spray that you can put in your bag. And then every over month, you click on three fragrances of your choice that you can try at home, and you receive the little cartouche that goes in the refill that goes in your purse spray, and you can experience during a month, and it can be a Dior Homme, a Chanel whatever, a Niche X, Eccentric, etc. Whatever, they have all type of different fragrances, and these are for people like basically, like you were saying, trying the dress. That's about trying the dress for a limited cost of $19 a month, where you can actually really try any type of perfume. You get advice online of, okay, for your type, we recommend that you choose this and that. And that has a phenomenal success. And these guys are really growing very fast. I don't know where it's going to go. They are not an e-commerce operator, so if you love the scent that you have tried, you click and you are going to a website that is either the website of the brand or Sephora.com or Saks.com or whoever has the best offer at the moment for it. But it is used as a basically new kind of sampling program. And it's very interesting that 150,000 people were ready to spend $200,000 a year for a service like that.
So it's a blend of a subscription model on the one hand and then paid sampling, and then they don't provide the original size, but they link to other websites who sell it. Is that correct? Yeah. Yeah.
They do sampling. When you go online, then you think you're buying from them, but you're not buying from them.
Okay.
You are referred to other
right.
websites.
Yeah.
So they are basically the middlemen, and they live from the membership.
Yeah.
I don't know how long it's going to be. You know, it's the Birchbox kind of business model for perfumery. I don't know how long they can live and be sustainable with this. But it's interesting to see that they have found rapidly several hundreds of thousands of people to follow on that.
I'm just going to say, I think what everyone has just said is what represents the incredible opportunity that the internet offers. So I might have started my conversation saying, oh, the internet can really be a problem. But when you hear these incredible things, your algorithm, something like Scentbird, the opportunities that you give your customers and growing with all this sampling, it's a tremendous opportunity. It's the kind of thing that a small niche company can only hope for in terms of reaching new customers. So it really is an exciting opportunity that the internet offers. And all those things that we just talked about are really extraordinary for niche brands like us. So that's the really positive part.
Thank you so much, Bailey. And you know, in view of the time, and I promise to give you the opportunity to ask some questions, I will thank you again for your participation. Thank you for being here. Oh, yeah, sure.
A question I have for all of you is, I read that for a lot of e-commerce, there is a big, big problem with the return goods. What's about that? It's happened to you or not? Because some e-shop closed for simple reason that they can send back the perfumes they don't love, and you have to substitute.
That's correct.
I mean, what's happened? So at the end of the story, you lose a lot of money because the return goods is not perfected.
Well, you know, it's always an issue, even when people come back to the store and you recognize your bag in their hand and it's already written. And I'm like, usually people go out of the store with this bag. They don't come in with this bag. And they're like, yeah, you know, somebody offered me this and it's already open. And well, actually, they offered it to me like this. And every time it's a pain in the neck. So I guess it's pretty much the same thing as people returning on the...
Sorry, but it's not the same thing because you have also a shipment cost.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, this is the nature of doing e-commerce. And, you know, maybe this will also give us the opportunity to find another subject, you know, in the realms of e-commerce. Thank you again, Bailey. Thank you, Renata. Thank you, François. Thank you, Sylvia. Thank you for being here. Or for your presence, for coming. And I would like to give the word to the lady who had a question. Maybe have we have a microphone, Valentina, over here?
Very interesting, but I want to bring up a point. You kept flashing up their e-commerce partners, e-commerce perfumery, all of this. I think you left out a very important word, and it's called authorized. An authorized e, as well as an authorized brick and mortar, an authorized e-commerce retailer. Now, I know from the history I have with Bailey that she runs one of the tightest ships in the industry. Her chain of custody on her product is practically low-jacked. Yet every once in a while, she's betrayed. And I know Aedes Juvenistus, same thing. You keep a tight, type ship. So I'll say you two are the exception to the rule. But most companies, there wouldn't be the flood of merchandise out there on the internet or Amazon or fly-by-night sites if A, the distributor is either not being loyal and is backdooring the merchandise, or more often, the actual fragrance house in Paris or Europe or wherever they're located signs distribution deals, but they're backdooring the merchandise themselves. So they're betraying their distributor. But is it all in the name of greed? You said just a few minutes, seconds ago about it's all about the money. You wouldn't have the Amazons or all these crazy sites out there, or the discounting. We're not even touching upon counterfeit goods. But it's a two-way street, and who are the culprits? Who's doing this? You said about an official site? I love an official site. An official site should give the whole history. The official site should give a list of all the sizes and products and all, but they shouldn't give prices. They should tell you where their authorized brick and mortars or their authorized e-retailers are. But they should not be competition to your brick and mortars who, years ago, this whole show, Niche Parfumers, it's your brick and mortars who started this whole industry. Now, yes, if they go on and have an e-commerce site, fine. If someone who doesn't have a brick and mortar has an e-commerce site, that's fine. But don't let the creators of the fragrance or the distributors be in direct conflict or, what am I trying to say? Be the direct competitor to a brick and mortar or a legitimate authorized web dealer.
Thank you. That's a great statement, which is very valid.
I'm just going to make one comment. Can I just say, Kathy, it's so interesting because we've found our products on websites, and they have a certification that this is an original product. It is not a counterfeit product. And yet, they're not authorized to sell our products. So it's kind of like, well, oh, gosh, you have a certified product. And, it's like the... Yeah, exactly. So it's, but I think the authorization word is actually a very key one.
And you know, for the most part, you know who betrayed you, but you're put in a hard work space. Do I close?
I just wanted to say one thing. I work for a major brand, a big, not a niche brand, and we don't sell from our site. We have a site for information, and we have quite a bit of work trying to just work with all of the countries in the world to try to get the names of the authorized sites. So, you know, whether it's contacting El Salvador or contacting China or contacting the United States, it's a lot of work that the brand does do, but I think I agree 100% that being authorized is super important, but there's a lot of work to be done on both sides.
So. Thank you.
Something not we are talking about the authorized, you know, e-commerce. There's a, based on internet shopping is no boundary. But for the brand, you need to keep in mind, different countries have different import regulation, import tax. So different country, the price will be different. And some e-commerce sites will sell outside European without even, will deduct the VAT. So the price difference can be over 50%. So end up, you, as a brand, very difficult to find a distributor in some of the country. Because end up, they do all the hard work, but the business all go to the internet shop.
I want to be honest here, because I think that what we see with unauthorized retailers or unauthorized players, say, who sell the merchandise at a discounted price, where does it come from? And how do you keep your house clean? And so to be honest, I do believe it is an effect on e-commerce or say a phenomenon that we can observe on the internet. But to be frank, the internet is not the source of it.
It's the distributors or the actual houses.
Thank you.
You have to be, it's all about greed, because any distributor or house has to know that if X thousands or hundreds of thousands of goods are going to this part of the world or a retailer, they can't physically sell this. So it's going out the back door, but nobody's going to admit to it. They're going to complain about it. But if you want to know where the culprits are, they're not far in this building, as well as other corporate offices here.
If I may, because we are also involved in distribution of niche perfumery in different markets, you have brands who know how to, control their distributions. You have brands who sometimes cannot control their distribution, and you have brands who close their eyes. And I think real life or internet, it's exactly the same thing. And then you have the brands that you contact as a distributor saying, like, you know, you're sold in a bad place, in a bad manner, at a bad price. And they're like, oh my God, I don't know where it comes from. And then you're coming every year to Accents or to PD or wherever saying the same thing, and the same thing happens. I'm not talking about internet right now. I'm talking about real life, you know, stuff. See, Silvia probably knows it in Italy. I know it in Russia.
There has to be vetting. And you ask any people who have been here for the 8 or 9 years how careful they have to be with people who print up a business card and say they have a boutique. And if you really took the time to go see on Google Earth even, that the address they give you is a forest or a parking lot, that these people are just using it as a ploy to get merchandise to sell on another market.
Exactly. So I think that what you're saying is exactly the same thing. Like, you have brands who know how to manage things, and you have brands who want to manage things. I think that's the key word. And then you have brands who just want to make money this year, and they don't really think about if they're making it next year as well. So it's just, you know, a matter of where you're putting, in which basket you're putting your business. That's it.
I think this is an excellent topic for another discussion panel. Because it is relevant, it has been haunting us for years, decades. So I will be happy, someone will be happy to dig into this a little further. And again, thank you for your participation. Thank you for your participation, for coming, and have a good weekend and a great time at Essence.